Hachette Audio presents The Women's War, written by James Patterson and Sean Serafin, read by Robin Miles. Chapter 1. 2 years ago. While all the other girls in kindergarten doodle pictures of ponies and rainbows, I would draw myself parachuting out of helicopters and landing on dictators. My little stick figure would karate kick 12 other stick figures, somehow making them explode in the process. And then I'd aim my portable missile at the obvious target, a dragon. Nearly 30 years later, I'd be a Marine Corps colonel riding on a Huey. The only difference between the girl in my crayon drawings and the real me is that I didn't have a parachute. I'd use a rope. And the dragon caught in my crosshairs wasn't a big lizard with wings. He was a little lizard, with total dominance over the U.S.-Mexican narcotics trade. His name was Diego Carrera. We were mid-flight, northwest of Diego's location, which was a compound tucked in the outskirts of a Mexican town called Matamoros. It was nearly midnight, dark, hot, damp. 18 members of my platoon were riding in 3 separate Bell Huey helicopters, flying low enough to read road signs and fast enough not to bother. I scanned the terrain below using the scope on my M16. The goal was to spot anyone who might be on a rooftop with heavy weaponry. Was I scared? No. Was I lying to myself about not being scared? Yes. We'd been hunting Diego Carrera for 3 years. I, personally, had been assigned to 6 different raids on his drug fields and had been introduced to his legendary business etiquette firsthand. Yet I never got the pleasure of introducing him to my M16. Our helicopters banked left. We were avoiding the city's population. It was a sizable town, but not sizable enough that the growl of a chopper would go unnoticed. The entirety of our intel came from an anonymous source who divulged only a single detail about himself. His name was the Fat Man. We knew nothing else about him. We had no idea if he was a defector from Carrera's cartel or if he was the governor of Maine. Fat Man? I pictured a bloated, balding car salesman with crusted mustard on his tie running to payphone booths with borrowed quarters to call me. This morning, he gave us the best news we've ever had.
Carrera is in Matamoros tonight.
2 hours later, we were airborne. I kissed my kids goodbye and tried super hard to seem like a normal mom. I'm not, though. There are 3 main things that can go wrong while jumping out of a helicopter. You could get shot before you jump. You could get shot while actually falling. You could get shot after you complete your fall. On this mission, we didn't anticipate there would be a 4th thing that could go wrong. Your enemy kicks your teeth in. I had on heat-protective gloves, but I let my boots absorb the majority of the work. I pinched the cord with the arch of 1 foot against the instep of the other. I don't know how the friction didn't cause a small forest fire, but honestly, my boots have never shown signs of burn. Credit the U.S. Marine Corps for that, or me eating salads. The ground greeted me like a speeding truck. Wham! Release, roll, get to position, crouch, aim, hold. Lieutenant Rita Ramirez hit the field 2nd, taking front watch. She was my no-nonsense assistant team leader, so she'd be the caboose once our human caravan got going. Sergeant Kira Holmes, the best navigator and the best shot, led on point as our sniper. My allies. My 2 best friends. I'd never had less intel on a situation, and it was making me an anxious wreck. But my job as colonel was to win the Academy Award for seeming non-wrecked. The shrubbery up ahead was starting to afford us a view as we approached it. I could see the backyard of Diego's compound in front of us. Showtime. In general, This hombre used two or three roaming guards even when he was the visitor to a location. I'd have loved to believe these men would be his worst troops, the ones who drew the short straws and had to take the graveyard shift by obligation, the majority of their thoughts on whatever discount porn they might be missing out on. But that's a dangerous assumption. These could be his best soldiers. We divided into our three teams, two to engage from the sides and one to come over the back wall. Alpha team, Bravo team, Charlie team. Rita and I took Alpha toward the driveway. Quiet and invisible. Those are the golden adjectives. We moved with as much silence as our boots would allow. No scuffling, no talking. Moving along routes that yield as much visual cover as possible. Bracing ourselves for the most complicated phase. The entry. Ideally, you fast rope directly on a target, but Diego had used RPGs in the past, rocket-propelled grenades. So no, the prospect of hovering in the air like a noisy piñata while angry men with rockets watched you from below was not desirable. 15 seconds up there would be an eternity. Too much potentially bad luck involved, no thanks. My platoon didn't like bad luck. My platoon didn't even like good luck. We preferred drawing up 200 different football-style diagrams with X's and O's, staring at maps and sketches, and letting everyone verbally shoot holes at our plans until we found one plan that seemed logistically bulletproof. We passed quietly through the gate, and we arrived in the courtyard. Already? Wait a second. This breach took no effort. Oddly, this was the first sign that things were about to go horribly wrong. The place was fully abandoned. From above, the compound looked like a normal set of buildings, but here at ground level, you could see this interior was hollow, literally hollow. Another group had already met us from the far end of their horseshoe-shaped journey, Bravo team. We were all kind of staring at each other through a very empty structure. Just some pillars in an old house with zero furniture. Bravo, clear, said the Bravo team leader from a back room. My heart sank. Charlie, clear, said the Charlie team leader. Charlie had already arrived from the middle. Is this over? Alpha, clear, I said, barely able to hide the disappointment in my voice. I wasn't getting nominated for that Oscar anytime soon. My platoon quickly began to scour the complex. There was nobody here. Was the fat man lying? And then Kira found the first sign of what was to come. Blood. Lots of it. I was thinking we had just executed the biggest failure ever. I was wrong. The failure was just getting started. Chapter 2. Diego Carrera was much more evasive than our mission budgets could handle. Some of our top Pentagon brass said he's just not qualified to be a priority. But during his rise to glory, he butchered nearly 2,900 human beings, most of them innocent citizens, many of whom were children, with the worst aspect being how he did it. It's a process he lovingly calls El Padrón. The first time I saw photos of El Padrón, I threw up. I thought I'd seen it all. I'd been on over 50 missions in 12 years and led combat action in 5 different nation states, but I'd never seen anything as harsh as El Padrón. It's like the guy was setting a world record for the most disturbing usage of pliers. And there in that empty compound in Matamoros, I was about to get my first personal taste of it. Fat man, this is Spider Actual. Do you copy? I tried my radio on the off chance that the fat man was patched in. Fat man, you there? He wasn't. Kira had blood on her sleeve from brushing up against a dark wall that was absolutely drenched with it, fresh, bright red. I began making my way to the roof of Diego's compound. Something was wrong here. very wrong. Yes, it's possible that Diego was tipped off ahead of time. But beyond my annoyance at being evaded, there was a growing unrest in me. How can this place be literally empty? Fat man, do you copy? I said again as I climbed up.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.